It's a very good morning to all the participants. I record my sense of gratitude to the St. Saviour's College for Women, Aluva, the management, the principal, the head of the department, Dr. Lima Antony, and the entire team of English department. And a special note of thanks to Dr. Soumi for inviting me to be a part of this Spectra 2020 webinar series. So when the whole world is reeling under the pandemic, it's a welcome note from the Department of St. Saviour's to conduct such a webinar series with an attractive name, Spectra 2020, and I'm so happy to be a part of that. My topic is the South African literature, the flares of political, social, and cultural dimensions in South African fiction. We academicians and researchers are well aware and well familiar, very familiar with many literatures. And so when taking literature as a part of our life, we know that literature reflects life. It adds to reality, but it does not describe. It enriches the necessary competencies that our daily life requires and provides. And in this aspect, we believe that it has irrigated the necessary competencies or the life, our life, which has become a desert, has been irrigated by the literature that we love to learn and live. It is in literature the concrete outlook of humanity finds its expression. The literatures written in Africa, Asia, and West Indies exhibit authentic responses to the human condition aggravated by the social, cultural, and collective consciousness of the individuals. These new literatures represent a hail blend of authority and experience in complex human situation, and also the economic, political, cultural changes occupies the major form of this literature. And the central assertion of this literature is the logical transition or the cultural transition, continuity or the affiliation or identity is the talk of the literature or forms the major part of literary pieces. So my talk will be about African literature and then about South African literature, South African fiction, and then going to the main part of political, social, and cultural milieu. So when to talk about this African literature, modern African literature emerged out of the colonial encounter between Africa and Europe. Literature of Africa is a part of gift to the world. Chinua Achebe, the most celebrated Nigerian writer, defines African literature as the sum total of national and ethnic literatures of Africa. Gill presents Gordimer's observation about African literature as a writing done in any language by Africans themselves and by others of whatever skin color who share the African experiences and who have what she terms as Africa-centered consciousness. So like the other literatures, literatures of the other nations, African literature enjoys what we can say an enviable antiquity, though its new medium is English. African literature is a serious intellectual and cultural activity with beautiful expression of the tumultuous changes happening all over the world or in Africa. It has been used as an instrument of instilling awareness, fostering national consciousness, thereby reminding the Africans of the inhumanities and the atrocities imposed on them by the colonial people, the forces of the colonial. And we know that this Africans are misguided by the individuals or the others to make them modern, and thereby these people have suffered a lot in the hands of the people, or the colonials, and their literature has been inspired by the reappraisal of the place. African literature written after 1945 is part of oral tradition. We see that that's what it's a part of oral tradition. And George Joseph in Contemporary of Africa, he writes about the oral tradition of the literature both in English and in Africa. He refers to English literature or the English Europeans as something referring to the diaries and the letters, while the African literature refers to oral literature or orature in verse or in prose. So when we talk about this oral literature, the prose is historical or mythological, where these people, these African people, use call and response technique to narrate the stories. So in the, that is what we say that stories, oral stories, there are so many traditional oral stories that has not been recorded by writing, but it has been recorded by the writers who came to know it through the other call and response. And so there, they use, it's a traditional form of folklore story, they use the tale of the trickster characters. In the folklore, they use trickster characters. For example, they say small animals uses its wits to encounter the larger creatures. So for example, there is called an Anansiya spider, small spider, in the popular folklore of Ashanti people of Ghana. And Ijapa, the tortoise, it's a popular Yoruba folklore, and also Sankura, a hare belong, that is the traditional folklore of East and Central Africa. And also we know that Africa in this gained liberation, most of the African nations gained liberation in 1950s and 1960s. And so at that time, people thought that what will be the major themes, or the what were the major themes used by the writers in the African literature. And so we know that this Africa has been representing the colonial encounter and the effect of colonial encounter in the writings. So African literature completely exhibited themes of liberation and independence. And we know that this Africa was influenced by the colonialism. There were Western languages, English, French, and Portuguese, started flooding into Africa, and people started using that language to write. And also the major themes of African literature, if you take it, Africa's past and present, tradition and modernity, indigenous and foreign, individualism and community, socialism and capitalism, development and self-reliance, Africanity and humanity, the rights and roles of women, historical confrontation during Africans' colonial era, all that have become the part or the themes of African literature. And in this time, in 1930, a group of three writers, they started a movement, that is Emmy Cisser and Leopold Shankar and Leon Damas. They started a movement called Negritude. That was completely a movement started to show the protest towards French Revolution. And it is this movement that paved the way for the writers to express their feelings in African or their own European literary form. Thus, the literary endeavor of Africa is the crisis and the pain and the agony of the Africans who became scapegoats in the hands of the colonials. Coming towards to African fiction, we say that the first among the African fiction to gain attention was the powerful slave narratives from the West. So to talk about the slave narratives, the first slave narrative was the interesting narratives of life and adventures of Oluwadin Ekino, that was written in 1789, which vividly focuses the horrors of slave and slave trade. But soon after, the Africans started writing in the Western languages, English, French, and Portuguese. After that only, Joseph Ephraim Huxley, the first African, he wrote the first African novel in English, Ethiopia Unbound, Studies in Race Emancipation, that was written in 1911. And so keeping the immense richness of the oral tradition and also oral culture of the backdrop of the writings, the African writers expressed their views through fiction, whose predominant concern was the people and the African scenario, which were under the colonial conquer or the colonial domination. So next we see that this African literature or African fiction becomes a new world of literary activity where the contemporary scenario or the reality of the African nation was portrayed. And then we come to writers who were very prominent. West African writers such as Oli Soyinka, Chinua Achebe, Osman Sebene, Kofi Avenor, Kamara Ley, and East African writers Ngugiwa Thiong'o, Oket Betek, Thomas Mefalo, Eskia Mafele, and also Dennis Brutus, they wrote about the horrendous rule of the colonial people and also the sufferings and also the predicaments of the black people there. All these writers, they wrote that what is happening in the streets. Actually, what is happening in the streets? What's happening in Africa? Their authentic portrayals of the real life situation paved the way to the outpour of the protest writings, that is the writings of the people, to showcase to the society what or what way the black people were living through. And they recorded the apartheid. Yes?
Can I interrupt? Your PPT is not visible on the screen now. So you are visible, but the PPT is not visible.
Yes,
now. Can you do it?
Yeah, sure. I'll do it.
Ma'am, this happens when somebody tries to present their screen. So I request all the participants to not present their screens. When participants present their screen, the presentation kind of goes off the spotlight. So please don't do it.
For some, it's visible. It seems that you must pin the presentation to your screen. Each participant should pin the presentation to your screen.
Is it visible now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. And so these writers have recorded the apartheid, pre-apartheid, apartheid, and the post-apartheid scenario in their writing. So we are now coming to South African literature. South African literature is a wing of African literature written in South Africa or by South Africans living in other countries. And being not a single entity, South Africa has been diverse ethnic groups and language, people speaking different languages. It's a distinctive literature in many African languages as well as Afrikaans. And also, the South African social, political, and economic history contributed greatly to the emergence of the literature of South Africa. And it was showcasing rare gems of literature. So we were able to get a lot of the rare gems of literature, rare writings by different writers of South Africa. As a serious intellectual and cultural entity, or the literature that emerged from the hardships of the people and also recorded by the writers, the rulers or the colonial recorded by the writers, but the colonial white people, they have completely eroded or they have completely oppressed the black people, that the victimized people and also the victimized writer started to express or record the predicaments and the sufferings and the reality of these people in their writings. So it has been acclaimed around the world for its innovative and radical approaches to the art of storytelling and the reworking of the language also. And also we know that South Africa, as it has a diverse ethnic groups, 11 they were officially accepted, or 11 languages were there, official 11 languages. And the annual publishing output favors English. That is, English comes first and African second, with 9 indigenous languages trailing behind with various shades of relevance. So South African English writings, they wrote about colonial writings and also liberal radical writings by whites. But when comparing to the writings of the black people, their texts were only, that is, their text range from the complexity of human situation or some ideologies like non-racialism, pan-Africanism, and about all the liberation or movements and their difficulties they experienced in their life. To say about the South African literature. It is nothing but the conflict between the white conquerors and the conquered blacks, between the white masters and the black servants, between the village and the city. So this is what the South African literature thinks that, or it objectifies that. We see, let us go to see black literature, because it is one of the prime important literature that marks South African literature in the world level. So black writing has always been under the fence, and for the during the 250 years of slavery, it was a legal crime for the blacks to read and write. The experience of oppression provoked them to write. So they stressed the need to report and to define the conditions of the days. And the writers felt that it is the intrinsic duty of the writers to communicate the wishes of the people to the society and to present the reality of the South African scenario. And so the writers on the, we can see that the black literature continues as one which is always under suppression or always under the pressure, and they are protesting against it, and they write their experiences there. So they were writing in English, Portuguese and Dutch. Later on, for a broader reach, they start writing in English. And to talk about the black writings started flooding into the South African literature because these people, first it started written, it was written by the immigrants who felt alienated and also isolated in the land. But they were also taken up by the mesmerized beauty of that, or they were mesmerized by the beauty of the South Africa. So to talk about black writing, I must say that this was the Mehudi was the first novel written by Sol Plaatje, because he was the founding father of the black literature. So he, what did he write in that novel was the trial of the Tswana people, that is encountering the Zulus under Shaka, and also the white people, that is the that is encountering or that's confronting and the white people's challenges, and also moving towards the interior. The writing Mehudi completely showcases the difficulties of the people, of course black people in the landscape. And later Thomas Mafalo wrote about Chaka, and this is the first novel written in English and translated in many other languages also. So when we talk about this, we after this Chaka, the South African government, that they implemented emergency, state of emergency, and many writers were sent to exile, many books were banished, and also the passport of Alan Paton, the writer, was confiscated for 10 years. And in this situation, people started writing protest literature. Alexla Gumas, A Walk in the Night, it completely talks about the difficult situation of the South Africans in this black country. That is, they say themselves as black, their country as black, and under the colonial rule. And so these three writers, not only these three writings, I have just focused on these three writings, the whole black writings, many of the writings which we are going to see in the later part of my talk, talks about or speaks about the reality of the situation, or the reality of the real life people started or the people were encountering in South Africa. So next is what we see, the Drum magazine, or the African Drum, because we saw in the first there is a Negritude movement which started to give the South African literature a special value. And this Drum magazine, the African Drum, this was started by in 1950. This, the writers thought that their voice should be heard to the people, or their voice could be echoed to the people. So they wanted something else, the medium to express their visions. And so it was launched by Robert Crisp, journalist. And at that time, the editors were Joe Rathby, Don Scott Fala, Zuma, Anderson, and the writers who constantly contributed to the writing of writing to Drum magazine, it's otherwise called African magazine, was Peter Abrahams, Alex Laguma, Eskia Mafalele, and Richard Wright, and goes on with Themba, Nkosi, and Nyakasa. So this is what this Drum magazine was. One source or one vehicle for this African people or the African people or the victimized writers to voice out to the world that we are in a situation where we are no man in our own country. And the same thing is afterwards, when you see this, in the mid of 1960, these four writers, the new rush of literary blood, that is Jan Rabi, Etienne Lorax, and Brighton Breitenbach, and Andrew Brain, they started Dicestagers, that is the 60s, like that. Dicestagers, this movement, these four started. First, they started in writing in English, and later they started to write in, first they started to write in Afrikaans, and then later they started to write in English. These people completely used the medium to expose or to exhibit to the people the real atrocities imposed on the people by the war. And what's a speciality about this is because they started writing in Afrikaans and later only it was translated into English. So many of the works are still now or till now is not been completely translated. But many of their works have been translated into 30 languages. I hope it is translated into 30 languages. So next we will go to this. So here comes the colonial writing or colonial how this writing started after the colonization of the Englishmen. So we see that the confrontation between two civilizations and cultures made the South African writers contribute to the literature. So numerous writings that extolling the great tradition of South Africa appeared in the literary scene. And the fact that the backdrop of the novel is South Africa and the events incorporated with the story is South African traditional values and the episodes and the political situation is not only an isolated or it is not a stereotypical writing of the people. Because that is the need of the hour for the people and they wanted that to write, or maybe I can say that it's the conscious effort of the South African writers, those who wishes for the emancipation of the literary writings and also to eradicate or to erase out the prejudices of the Western stereotype writings or the Western writers who have distorted the beauty of the South African literature. So here we see that these people always pictures, we will go to the English, glorifies the Englishman how. Whenever these South African writings that emerge in the literary scenario, there were two options. Because this, I can say that Eskia Mafalele, he was the person or he was the writer, one who very consciously scrutinized the English writing, and through his novel The African Image, he has completely taken up or he has referred to the English writers Charles Scully and Sarah Gertrude Millin, whose writings that is teemed with racial prejudice. Because at that time he welcomed the writings of Nadine Gordimer, William Plomer, Vandy Post, because they all dealt with the people of, that is, we can say that oppressed Negro people. So here, SK says that all the English novels, they glorify the Englishman and pictures the aboriginals as say the dangerous savages or faithful servants. And all this has been, the same picture has been given in King Solomon's Mines and Alan Quatermain, and there animals are humanized and blacks are brutalized. So when we see about, or when we come to see the beginning of South African literature, we can say that one of the towering figures of the South African literature was Olive Schreiner. She is a feminist and a daughter of a Calvinist missionary, a progressive-minded writer who was born and brought up in South Africa. So she wrote the first text, The Story of an African Farm. This was the founding text of South African literature. She wrote in that text about a group of white people, white settlers, adults, children, even animals, and how these the group of peoples or the group of characters live, and the horrendous life of the slaves as well as the people, those who are working in under the white people. The other novels, Trooper Peter Halkett of Mashonaland, Mutiny, Women and Labor, they also expose the brutal activities of the British South African Company. From that time onwards, a damn burst of pure literature, or we can say protest literature, started to flood the fertile plain of South African policy. So we see among them, we have some writers, stalwarts of South African writers, who have carved a special place for them, or Bessie Emery Head, Nadine Gordimer, Alan Paton, Coetzee, and Andrew Breen. We talk about Bessie Emery Head. She's a leading South African woman writer who wrote the traumatic experiences, disposition, alienation, dislocation, and also the beauty of the nature and the human heart in that. Her novels were Rains Cloud, Maru, Question of Power, and African Saga suit well with the contemporary political, social, and cultural scenario of South Africa. To talk about Alan Paton, he in the first novel, Cry the Beloved Country, he speaks about the people caught into the racial conflicts of South Africa. His novels, The Land, is a novel, we can say that it's Go Debbie, and the novels, The Land, and To Fowler of, all these novels completely say about the racial conflict and also the people, those who are affected by this racial conflicts, and also by the what we can say, it is in the life they encounter under the white colonials. And so when we talk about all these writers, Nadine Gordimer is, I can say that she's one of the towering figures of South African literature. And like her fellow Nobel laureates, Gunda Cross and Alexander Solzhenitsyn, she is also one of the writers who wanted to, or who has the inner thought to realign the situation or the history of South Africa through her writings. And then we, because her always her writings have, or her writings focus on, or center around, we can say that bloody massacres, the culprits, she tells us the whites, and also the black people who were always trying to come out of the situation, but never they could. Her writings, Lying Days, Occasion for Loving, and also Burgess' Daughter, July's People, Get Alive, Pick Up. It goes on like that. All these novels tell you or tell us not only one situation, one episode, one predicament, but it talks of varied or myriad dimensions of South African literature. And she to talk about Coetzee. Coetzee is the most applauded writer and the fourth South African writer to win the Nobel Prize. He dealt exactly the situations, the power, the degradation of the blacks in his novels. His Life and Times of Michael Kay, Age of Iron, and also Foe, and Dustlands, Waiting for Barbarians, and all these tell the real, or he presents the real South Africa to the world stage. And to talk about Chinua Achebe or S.K. Mafalele, all these people, they are very much taken up, or they are very much empathetic towards the black people, and they are also a part of that. They wanted to convey the real situation of South Africa. And Chinua Achebe, we know that Lone Angaratis and Hills of Savannah, Things Fall Apart, each one depicts the culture as well as political and the social situation of South Africa, or the milieu of South Africa, and how it has affected the people, and how the people was now battling for their space and survival in their own country. And then to talk about Henri Philippe Brin, he thought that he wrote in Afrikaans and later he started writing in English. His book, Chinese Van Dyke, and that is in Afrikaans, Knowledge of the Night, was the first book to be banned by the African government. And not only Brin's book, but also Alan Paton's book and Nadine Gordimer's Bajaj's Daughter, World of Strangers, Late Bourgeois World, all these books were banned by the South African government because the books support the blacks and they were at least in a way were a written document against the revolt of against the British people. And so next I thought that we will go to the main part of our talk, the political milieu, social milieu and the cultural milieu. The words I have just taken these words because it suits well with our political situation of South Africa. I have cherished the ideal of democratic and free society in which all persons live together in harmony with opportunities. It is an ideal which I hope to live for and achieve. But if needs be, it's an ideal for which I am prepared to die. We know all, we all know Nelson Mandela, the iconic hero of South Africa, was sacrificed 27 years of his life for the liberation of the black in the Robben Island prison. So we are so much taken up by Nelson Mandela, not only the South Africans, all of us, we Indians or Australians or anyone, we also revere Nelson Mandela as an iconic hero. And when we talk about the politics and fiction of South Africa, we note so that South African, we know that South African literature, which is closely related to the political, cultural and social factors, is directly or indirectly influenced by the political developments of the country. The South African writer, who were very much peculiarly attached to the apartheid and the consequent cultural, colonial and political situations and the psychological situations, gave pure protest literature and the portrayals of the hostility between the whites and the blacks. We know that the Robert Bowyer, in his novel, in his writing, Atrocity and Amnesia, he opines, personal relations seem meaningful when they are touched or threatened by the turmoil associated with political realm. And Gordimer believes that a writer is part of the creative consciousness of the society, and he is shaped by the society, and reflecting all the situations or all the incidents that happen in a society. So in one of her interviews, she said that a writer is selected by his subject being the consciousness of his own era. I think that this is what all the writers do, and they become the consciousness of the era. And we know that it is very impossible to think, or it's virtually impossible to think South African literature without politics. Derek Attridge, he says that, or he sees Coetzee's fiction as the private serves as a corrective to the public. And also he says that, George Orwell says that, your society faces crisis when the history is forgotten or neglected. Lombardi, he sees history as an integral part of writing, where politics is the main that is what we can say. Politics is the main feature of all the writings. And also S.K. Mafele and says that I revere the writers, the white writers as well as the black writers who dwell sympathetically on the fate of the oppressed hero. So when we come to the main part of the history or the politics of South Africa, I can very well say that most of the novels in South Africa are written by South Africans or any other authors about South African situation. The political movements form the backdrop of the novels, one or the other novels, most of the novels I can tell. So the political movements of the late 1970s, that means the liberation movement, the Sharpeville massacre, Soweto uprising, black conscious movement, the strikes of 1918, war wars, all these forms the backdrop of the novels. All these were the talk of the novel. This occupies the central stage of the novels. So when we talk about this I'm just listed the here, and I'm going to talk about first about the Sharpeville massacre that was completely, I can tell you sure that the Sharpeville massacre was the backdrop, or that was a part of the novel of most of South African literature. And if you go with this, the blacks in South Africa were regulated by passes and were required to carry this pass, an official document, and they should produce it on demand by the white authority. And they faced pain of imprisonment if the black people fail or refuse to show. You can see in the picture, in the top, the people, a black person holding a pass. It seems as if similar to our passports. And these people, they have to hold this pass, and issuing are the passless were met with resistance during the 20th century. The issuing of passes became one of the cornerstones in the colonial racial South African country. And see, the African people, they became, our passes made them temporary sojourners where they were born. These people refused to carry the passes. So what happened was, the government also issued an order that this has to be made compulsory, and people, or the blacks, the Indians and the coloreds, cannot live in South Africa without the passes. So what happened was, people started protesting for them. The first initiative, or the first protest against passes, was initiated by Mahatma Gandhiji in 1906. And the second in 1913, first African men and women started to revolt against, or to demonstrative demonstration campaigns were started in Free State, that is Orange Free State, which is completely segregated for the black people. And in 1930s, I think that 1930s and after that, people started protesting against passes in Orange Free State as well as in Sharpeville, all the places. You can see in the picture that women were holding the placards that they don't want, and also pass burning campaigns were held by the people of South Africa, or that Orange Free State, and also by the various trade unions. The pass and the resistance, you can see in the picture, Sharpeville massacre happened. The pass and the resistance against this, or that moved forward, or that paved way for more liberation. Sorry, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, you can continue.
Yes. So the pass and the resistance campaign, the pass and the resistance against this has been carried out, or this helped the South Africans to mount against more and more liberations, and also liberation movements, and also massacres. So the African National Congress, that African National Congress planned to conduct a rally against the passes on 21st March 1960. So these people, many, the thousands of people, they started this marching towards a Sharpeville town, and they have planned only a very peaceful rally. At that time, the South African police failed to give the crowd an order that they are going to fire. And so the people were not given any prior instruction. The police started firing against the people, and people started running for life. And some people were shot at the back, and hundreds of people were shot at the back. And some people, to safeguard themselves, they started pelting stones at the police. So as a result, excessive force was used, and so many people were killed. And at the beginning, 69 were killed, and some 800s of them were wounded. In this condition, we know that many participants who took part or attended this Sharpeville massacre, this campaign was not a members of any political party. They were students, they were women and children. They attended this campaign because they opposed this pass laws also. When great many people in the town, Sharpeville town, they refused to carry passes, this government declared an emergency, telling that these people can be retained or that can be arrested without any question and held for 6 months. So many people died in the prison and also under the white policemen of torture and trials, and also they were of starvation, and completely many people were sent to life imprisonment, like our Nelson Mandela also. So thousands of the individuals, they thought that it is their need somehow to fight against the Sharpeville massacre. So they continued their fighting. So this resistance campaign lasted for 156 days, left 69 dead and 184 wounded. So in that time, when Gadamer was asked about the aesthetics of the history, she told that, you see, a historian can tell you the events that come about through the power shifts, but the novelist is concerned with the history of the individuals who make up the history. It's right, this history, this is even now we read it in the novels. And we are aware of that only because these writings have been documented by the African writers. So this we know very well that the carrying passes inside their country, and with that identification only they can live in their country. Means that is something, it's beyond imagination. And so the passes created a great hazard for the people, and that were documented and recorded. And that's what the first I've said, that the conservationist of Nadine Gadamer, it says that the Jacobus, the herdsman, and Marin, he says that there are people working in the farm without papers. If they are caught by the police, he says, I'll say to them, I don't know you, and maybe these boys were someone hiding in our farm with the other boys who are working in the past. You know, there are people, those who have no passes. There is Bidbui, who traveled 17 years ago from Rhodesia, still working in South African farm during this time when there are other records there without papers. And we know that Julai, a servant, he told that, I was working in a hotel and without papers. All of us working in the hotel kitchen have no papers. And in pickup, we say that Abdu, that is a garage boy, he's not a mechanic. He doesn't have a paper. But why do these people allow these blacks without papers to work in their farm and garages? Because to ensure cheap labor. And On Rage is the novel written by Wilbur Smith, a British novelist. But he's so confrontational writing about this South African situation. And here he speaks about the conflicts people undergo during these massacres and during these restrictions. And also the life and times of Michael Kay, of Hootsie in the fog season of end, and that is Alex Laguma's novel, that speaks about the conflicting situations which South Africa imposed on the people of their own country, and how they go through or how they endure all these difficulties. And Loretta Nekbo, she's called as the Sharpeville generation. She writes the novel, and novel of Sharpeville, and her protagonist are the characters who were completely tried and by the police in one or the other way, impel them to enter into the Sharpeville massacre or the demonstration. And also she writes about the after effect of that. And also this A Night of Their Own is completely unleashing the difficulty, the dark corridors which the blacks were treading through. So I know that all the writers, they were trying to make us aware of what was the situation where the blacks have been living through. And next, if you go to trees, and we can see the Soweto uprising, June 16, 1976. That's the another important political incident which took place in South Africa that becomes the backdrop or the top of the novels. So in the new South African government in 1953, they implemented a Bantu Education Act, that is a black education. There is For example, I can say that they have establishing separate black education department and asking them to prepare a curriculum for the black people. And here, Alistair Bowdy refers to Dr. Henry, the Minister of Affairs, is telling natives, blacks, should always be aware that they should not aspire for higher positions or equal to the white people. The blacks were not to be allowed to receive the kind of education which the whites are enjoying or they are experiencing. And instead, they should receive an education designed to provide them with the training to prepare the black people to work as laborers in the white settlement. Or he's saying that the blacks should know that they are inferior and they are given this sort of education only to prepare them hewers of wood and drawers of water in the white houses. So this thought made the black feel that they are secondary and they are being refused all the rights in this country. So people start that. The main aim of this Bantu Education Act was to replace English with Africans. And so we all know that Britishers, when they were in our country, they use our Indians only to take in the positions of the clerks and the very mean jobs. They never allowed us to go for the higher post in the government. So the same thing, the South African Students Movement and the Black Conscious Movement, all these, they started that they have to make something else, or they have to fight against this, otherwise their life would be meaningful. And so this is what that I wanted to tell you is this Bantu education, how it got its name Soweto Uprising. Soweto is the name given to the townships where the people, the black people live. It is the southwestern townships of Johannesburg. And in one morning, June 16, 1976, thousands of students started marching towards Sharpeville, that is the Orlando Saucer Stadium of Anne, to protest them regarding the, sorry, Swami, can you hear me? Can you hear me, Swami?
Yes,
yeah. Okay. So they started marching towards Johannesburg in order to show their protest against this. And the black residents of Soweto and also the people, the students, the teachers, all of them just marched towards that stadium. So when they were going, marching very peacefully towards that Orlando Saucer Stadium, 50 policemen stopped the people and they asked them to turn and go away. So at this juncture, people were not prepared to go away from whatever they have planned. And so the the European colonials, they were angry and they started tear gas. They started using tear gas and also live bullets to the people. And the people did not know what to do at that time. Hundreds of teachers accepted the people's protest against this. You see, I met one of the lady from some European country. She told me that, I met her once there, she told that I took part in Soweto Uprising as a student when I was 14 years old. She's still living, she's a white. But she told that I took part in it because I felt that it's not necessary to replace English with Africans. It's inhuman. And I was taken to jail. So all these people, the Soweto Uprising, the people thought that, it's all about suffering. It's about suffering. The black people are suffering. It's about suffering. How to end suffering? That's why to end the suffering, they wanted to take this to the notice of the white people that we are not prepared to go with the language of English or the Africans. Because they thought that these Africans was the language of the oppressor. They all had placards in their hand. Down with Africans. Hell with Bantu education. Some people started singing songs which made the people, that is to urge with the power, urge with the spirit of this fighting, this fight, this protest, this rebellion. And so Soweto becomes a symbol of inhumanity, atrocity, and also we can say that lifeless. Just these people, they felt that we are living because, but we don't have any life, because this country is not ours, this place is not ours, education is not ours. So in this situation only, they say that the Black Conscious Movement, the head of the Black Conscious Movement, Sifo, says that when all these firing was going on, when they asked the policemen, they say that we could not distinguish between the mourners and the mob, because so many people died, and these black people, they went to attend the funeral, and of the washing of the hands, a custom of their own. And this policeman said that I can't differentiate between the mourners and the mobs. So again and again, they shot the black people. Many of them died. And when they were asked to collect the dead bodies, the white policeman told the black policeman to collect the brains of the black people with a shawl. So you can see that how difficult or how pathetic the situation of the blacks lived there. And this Soweto uprising also marks the inhumanity is done to the black by the whites. And so now we can see that I was telling about in the beginning of this social, this we saw about Nelson Mandela's words, which he was telling that I'm prepared to die for that. And this ideology really was based in the novel Burgess' Daughter by Nadine Gordimer, and she has made the hero Lionel, who was a white man who's spent his time or spent his life in the prison for the liberation of South Africa, which was his home, and for the liberation of the South African people, which was his human family. He died for the sake of what he was in prison also. And there were, I have seen here, you will see here Soweto novels. There were four Soweto novels that speaks completely about Soweto, completely about the inhumanity of Soweto, completely about the existence of the blacks. They are Serot's To Every Birth Is Blood, and Sephula's Right on the Whirlwind, Miriam Tally's Amantala, and Zamane's The Children of Soweto completely depict the Soweto uprising of 1976 and its aftermath. Memory is the Weapon of Don Matera. It speaks about the service of anti-apartheid activism in South Africa and how the blacks are living in the midst of all these things. So we can see next is, these are the pictures which you can see how the Soweto uprising people started running and people are marching towards, and how the placards they have with hell with Africans and other things. And to talk about Black Conscious Movement, this is a grassroots anti-apartheid movement emerged in the mid-1960s. That is, this was completely, this started by creating a vacuum, because so many people were jailed and put in imprisoned, and also they were trialed and killed, and all these difficulties they encountered, and these people wanted to focus it to the people. So the Black Conscious Movement is completely a movement started, or a social movement for the political consciousness. It records the strikes, all the strikes, Boer Wars, there is Anglo-Boer War I, Anglo-Boer War II, and also about all these wars, all these strikes, all these movements, they only concentrate on one thing, emancipation of the blacks. You can see the down, the Country My Skull, it's Crocs Country My Skull, and Cozy's, well, that is, we can say underground people, and also we can say Mephis, Welcome to Helbero, Age of Iron of Kutsi, and Midlands and Emergency. All these novels speak about the political and social tragedy unfolding the life of the people. One minute, I can just. Sorry, I forgot to put my charger there, and I forgot to switch on. Very sorry for the inconvenience. And also, the country ravaged by racism and violence. And also, all these writers, all these novels, they were concentrating on the unflinching effort to emancipate the blacks, to for the freedom, and to get them free from the clutches of the colonial rule. And This is the, so we come to this end of this political milieu. We say that the political rightment, the political commitment of the writers exhibiting this colonial dilemmas and the historical consciousness significant in the novels, along with the changing scenario of the South African history, is painted naturally sans artificiality. In text, in a setting of the freedom struggle and also of South Africa as the backdrop of novel, the authors dexterously merges history, politics, and fiction. So how could we will say that how this social milieu in the novel has been represented by the writers? Martin Luther King, who always concentrated or who always fought for the liberation of the black, is the iconic figure which I have taken there as the header of this social milieu. That is in South Africa. Here, Black Lives Matter. So it's not distant. What is that? Martin Luther King says that your dawn is not distant. You wait. You wait patiently. Fight for it. You can see your You can see your emancipation, your freedom, not in the very distant. And so we can say that writers are committed to the society in which they live. And an astonishing feature of the writer is that he or she passes on the issues which affect the society and the reality through the works. Williams in Culture and Society deserves that. A committed writer deals with real life situation because he or she is engaged in writing a specific period of a particular society. The primary obligation of these writers or to find out the social and the ethical issues in the society, and they have to find out the solution for that errors or the issues in the society. And also they say that the main obligation of these writers is to portray the genuine image of the society to the writers. And the committed writers, they always feel that, or they present the society from which they hail. That's what Chinua Achebe, Oli Soyinka and Nadine Gordimer, they completely presented the society from which they came, the horrors of the society, and how these horrors should be turned into happiness, or we can say that emancipation. And so we have Sarah Gertrude Millen and Sol Plaatje, and also Miriam Talley, Nadine Gordimer. They found fruitful experiences in the injustice of the minority rule. And so as a result, fiction came dominance quickly, because they were able to write much about the blacks and also about the whites. And Nadine Gordimer, when she was expressing her thought, she says that I have no religion, I have no political drama, dogma. The only thing which always was pestering my mind, haunting my mind, was the color bar is wrong and utterly indefensible. That's what the moral code I found in me, and I was able to write for the black people. We know that to deny people their human rights is to challenge their humanity. And also, South Africa is a multidimensional, beautiful, exotic, mysterious country. But unfortunately, there are a lot of injustices and evils happening there in the society. That is like, we can say, servitude, injustice, caste, class system, and also poverty that has completely made or demarcated the South African nation. And racial prejudice is especially abhorrent in the society. And the apartheid government, they enacted new laws from between 1948 and 1990. We know that apartheid, I don't want to tell you about apartheid, because it's enforced by the new South African government in 1948 and between 1990. And also these laws completely curbed the rights and the rights of the South Africans on the basis of the skin color. We know that racial discrimination, whites and the blacks. Blacks are the inferior and whites are superior. So on that, they have just implemented a lot of acts, apartheid new acts, where the most important two acts, there are against Land Act is there, then Existence Act pass, and so many are there. And I am concentrating on two acts there, the Prohibition of Mixed Marriages Act and the Immortality Act. See, this Prohibition of Mixed Marriages Act and the Immortality Act completely aims at curtailing the cross-racial relationship between the whites and the blacks. I'm not telling about only the relationship means the sexual relationship, not at all there. It's been the relationship between between the master and the servant, or between the sisters, brother relationship, or anything. Universal brotherhood is not there in South Africa. And also we can see that cross-racial relationship becomes the center part of the novels. And a sport of nature, the first happy relationship between black man Waila and the white woman Hilela occurs in sport of nature. That is completely a man and a wife. That is partner relationship. When Budge's daughter, there are writer pictures the relationship of Rosa and Basie. She calls him Zwalinzima. That is not at all a relationship of any other kind. That is a brother-sister relationship, because Lionel allowed the blacks to live in his home. And also about Julie's people, there is the relationship between the servant and the master, white master and the black servant. And too late, the Phalanthrope, the Path of Thunder, that also speaks about white-black relationship. And at last, the Path of Thunder, Lane and Sari, they flee to the Mozambique to find, because there's the Mozambique is a place where they can freely marry a white woman. And Mating Birds, the black Sidia and also white Veronica, they found it very difficult to have a life in this white dominion, that is South African country. And so this cross-racial relationship was completely condemned, and also Africans were completely tested and trialed by the white government if they find any white or the black relationship going on like this. And next is, we see the dilemma of the blacks. We can see that the new legislation, the new orders, that has completely curtailed the rights of the blacks and the white. They have imposed a lot of restrictions on the part of the blacks, and the blacks were denied of all the rights as a human being. You can say that he was no man in his land. He was always harried by the day and haunted by night by the thought that he is no one, he is secondary. And so this insecurity, this pain, this pressure, this longing or the craving for freedom made him feel that to live a life under the threat of always being spelled. And so to talk about the denial of rights, Miriam Tally, Nadine Gordimer, everybody, every writer, they witnessed the scenario. They witnessed the dilemma of the colonized Africans and others. So these people very realistically, very sympathetically portrayed the dilemma of the blacks where they were no man. And we can see that rights of education. We are talking about rights of education. There are separate schools for the blacks and separate colleges and university for the blacks. So I talk about Nadine Gordimer, and you may ask that why, I'm always talking about Nadine Gordimer, because I was so much taken up by Nadine Gordimer, the white writer who has been fighting for the black people. She was a political activist. She went in exile, and her books were banned. And even Nelson Mandela, after the release from the prison, he wanted to see Nadine Gordimer first, because she, I used to say, a white angel who sang the symphony for the black people. So she was, her mother and father were British descendants, service Russia, but they were settled in South Africa. Nadine Gordimer has seen the black suffering. So as a schoolgirl, she went to the Convent of Lady of Mercy. She was telling, I went to the Convent of the Lady of Mercy, but there was no mercy for the blacks. Again, I went to the dance classes, blacks were excluded. I went to the library, which is so precious for me, blacks were not allowed. This impinged my conscience, and I asked why. So this is the result, or this is why I started writing about for the white people. So here, when you talk about the education of the black people in the novels, Nadine Gordimer, she tells about in Burgess' daughter, Rosa, the school where Rosa studied is a mixed school, but there were separate classes for the blacks and the whites. And the English-speaking white girl always expressed to the blacks with some inferiority that they speak bloody boars, thick Afrikaners, and dumb Dutchess. And so they never mingled with the black people. And also in the novels of Revelations of Alistair Road, and also Secure's The Quiet Violence of Dreams. These speak about a student, Tepeso, who has been admitted to the mental asylum in Cape Town only because of the atrocities and the imposed on the black students by the white people. And also another novel is Young Blood. It speaks of Sifo. He's called the Young Blood, who is a school-going generation. What are the difficulties? What are the atrocities he encountered in his school life? And then we will talk about labor. Labor is, we know that South Africa is a beautiful country built by the labor of the black people. The roads, the cities, the factories, everything is built by the black people. So we say that in the conservation novel, they say that hundreds and thousands of blacks were in the farms. More than 80% of the people were working in the pig iron industry. They are making use of the blacks. You can see that it's been pictured there. The blacks always hold the there is the shawl and also the instruments during farming, that the nails became opaque and worn out, and it was wavering from one another, and they could not, even the blacks, they cannot touch it, they cannot feel it. And even Rosa tells that black men and women, children living in the living under insecurity, pressure, pain in the black, in the white farms. And she says that the dark satanic mills, they purchased the white labor for cheap source. So we can understand that purchase the white labor for the cheap source. That's why these people employ blacks in their farms. And also Lisa Frugard's Skinner Drift pictures the predicaments and the conflicts of the black farmers in the farms. And he was nobody in his own land. He was always intimidated by the fact that he is a mere black, and that the laborers felt they have no place to sleep even. They drop on the grass and sleep. Some people, over excessive work, they die even on the grass. I'm reminded of Elizabeth Barrett Browning's The Crying of the Children, where the children, after the excessive labor, they drop down on the meadows and sleep. So this is the condition of the black people in the farms and the fields and the mills also. So when the black characters appear in the novels, we know that they are only comic buffoons, savages or servants, nothing else. Even animals are humanized, but blacks are brutalized. That is what they say. So they live a life of oscillation, and anytime their life will be out of their control. And then we talk about living conditions of the people. I can go with the living conditions of the people. You see, all the authors, they say the black people live in the places where the whites will dump their waste. There's a picture there. White people dump their waste there. They make their homes with the tins and the boulders, which has been completely neglected or thrown away by the white people. You can see there in the novel Julie's People, Nadine Gordimer says that Julie's village is it's a habitation of mud houses. The cobwebs dangle there, dirt is there, the fowls enter into the home. They eat there, and the fowls and the chicks squawks. And also there is the goats are tethered there. And in Pickup, Julia is completely shocked to see the living condition of the living places of Abdul. Their goats are tethered there, human beings also tethered there. It was the word there. And she could see a dead sheep there, their sheep lying near the house, flies around them. So the blacks have no better living conditions, and they were oppressed and suppressed in their mind very well. And also we can see that other conditions, if you see it's segregation. They are segregated in all walks of life. Even if you see the picture, the train, in the toilet, in the bar, in the laundry. Imperial Laundry we wash only for the whites. Rex Theater for the colored people, non-white shop. You can see a picture, non-white shop, but there are shops where they may sometimes give. But Duma Dladla and black university professor says that, when I went to the shop, they give the kafir yesterday's stale bread. When the kafir goes for fruit, they give him half rotten, the black white stone by. This is black, he says then. Thus the blacks are segregated in all walks of life. If you see next is European hospital, non-European hospital. Drinking fountain, white color. Sitting, pavement, and walking. And you see in the beaches also, only whites. City of Durban under the section 37 of the Durban beach by laws, this bathing area is reserved only for the black people, sorry, white people. And you can see sympathetic one or one which one will touch our heart was natives, Indians and culprits. If you enter these premises at night, you will be listed as missing. Armed guards shoot and die and sight. So you can see that the black people cannot even live in their country, because if at all they went to a place where it is restricted for whites, they will be shot to death. And also Fanon in the book Black Skin and White Mask, he speaks about the very pitiable condition of the black people. He says, I quote, "The Negro is bad, the Negro is ugly, and the Negro is mean. The small boy is afraid of the nigger. Nigger is a Negro boy." And so evidently declares the segregation of the black people they undergo in their own land. And also Karega's Petals of Blood, that speaks about the conflicting situation of the black people in their own land. And Life in South Africa was a seminal text which tells the real life the blacks go through in South Africa. And also Buckingham Palace and District 6, they talk about the life of the colored king. And Emergency and Emergency Continued speaks about the emergency which the blacks endure in their life. And next is we'll go to the culture. And the culture is, you can say, South Africa or African continent is always referred to as dark continent. But I can say it's a rainbow nation with its 50 million people, known for its languages and religious beliefs. An ethnically diverse nation, South Africa is more than a cultural melting pot. It's a big, warm orgy of culture, full of different ingredients and amid surprises, and developing its richness over rich flavor over century. If you send in the down the pictures of Zulu culture, Setho culture, all these culture pictures I have just given there, and it is a multiracial country, demarcating distinct subgroups as with the color and also skin of the color, white, black, and also it's of many ethnic groups, Zulu, Xhosa, Beposwa, Tswana, Tosanga, Venta, all these people, they speak Bantu languages and they live there. And so much of the culture, South Africa's cultural activity has been a family, the art of storytelling, and their lifestyle, their beliefs, everything constitute the culture of South Africa. And one of the outstanding cultural elements or the main thing we have to think is it's the continent of which follows multiculturalism. Many diverse ethnic groups live there, and hybrid mixtures of different cultures coexist and give meaning to the culture of South Africa. We know that when we talk about culture, there will be myth and rituals. Myth and rituals and symbols are the elements of culture which explains or which depicts or which portrays the beautiful, glorious culture of any country. So here the writers uses the contemporary myth which illuminates the seamy side of the life and to highlight the public follies, troubles and uncertainty of life and death. And the art of, because all this culture and the myth and everything has not been, the art of storytelling was only in the beginning and writing was not at all documented. And so these novels, all the novels, they encapsulate the South African culture, and they are an unshakable testimony to the cultural discourses of racially divided country. And we say that the reality of the South African society is pictured through the culture. The writers depict the culture in order to picture the real South African society. The cultural splendor, the cultural glory of South Africa is being recorded or documented by the writers in their works. So the first thing I wanted to take is myth. We all know that myth means a story or something relating to the religion, or some actions It's not only something, a writing or a story, but it is an action, it is a deed. And here, writers are deeply fascinated by the myth of Mandela, and all the writers see Mandela as an iconic figure who spent, or who, not I can't say it's who spent, who sacrificed his life for the his own people. And no, it's not one or two, 27 years of his life during the Rivona trial, where with this, Nelson Mandela, so many others were also arrested and sent to life imprisonment. That is, we can say about Abraham Fisher and Walter Sisulu, all these people with Mandela were sent to life imprisonment. So Mandela's commitment and sacrifice can be paralleled with the heroes of the authors, of the writers of South African society and literature. Sorry. The novels Burgess' Daughter and Dulles' People illuminate the Mandela myth and parallels their action to Sir Mandela. Mandela is a savior, and his feat was godlike. And he did it, and sacrifice is needed for freedom is the word of Mandela. And so he did it. So here we see Lionel, who is just the replica of Mandela, who spent his time in the prison for the black people, for his breath was the liberation of black. So he lived and died. The African people in the novel, the Burgess' Daughter, speak about Lionel in the, he is our father. He is our father who saved us from the clutches of the white colonialism. And so then, now if you speak about the Dulles' People, Dulles is the servant of the white master Marvin and Smile. Bam. So he has saved the family while there was in Johannesburg, the situations were turning on. The black revolutions going on and the houses of the whites were burned. So this Dulles' People was written in 1981 by Nadine Gordimer, who was able to visualize that. That is before 13 years when apartheid was abolished. She was able to visualize that one day there will be a time when whites and blacks or the situations will turn against those black white people. So here, the charity of Mandela towards the black people is paralleled with the story of Lionel and Julie. And actually, Maureen used to call Julie is our frog prince savior. And next I go to the creation of biblical myth, and creation stories are three creation stories in Bible. That is the creation of the world, Genesis 1 and 2, Garden of Eden, Genesis 3, and Noah's story, Genesis 6 and 9, are taken as myths by the story. Yes? The time?
It's almost time.
The Bible story in Conservationist and also in Get Alive, author creates Cain and Abel story there. And Cain and Abel are brothers. Here Merin is seen as the Cain who has been expelled from the Garden of Eden. Likewise, Merin leaves the garden and he goes away. And also Paul, Garden of Eden, serves him as something else, brings his vision to serve the earth and live a life. Right? So this Bible story is completely taken by the authors who believe in Christianity, and also by the other authors. I take Noah's Ark. Noah, we know that Bible. God told Noah to take his family and others in the ark so that to sustain flood. He withstood the 45 days flood. Just like here, Noah taking the family of the master towards his home in a white yellow baki. That is, Becky is an art. Maureen and Bam says that he is the savior, one who saved us. And Noah, that is, Julie has been personified as the Noah of the Bible. This is all my perceptions, not the perception of the author. Author has given it. These are the perceptions of social and cultural myth and everything milieu that we see it. We see it when we read it. And the rituals are, we can say that Bruce Lingan says, a coherent set of symbolic action that has real transformative effect on individuals. We follow a lot of rites. We follow, that is, the rites from birth, funerals, and also we have funerary rites, birth rites, marriage, puberty. That's the right, the ways of living and conservation. It speaks about the rites of funeral and how that burial, decent burial, gives the transition from one world to the other world. And Islamic beliefs, though there are Zoroastrians, Zulus and others, the writers speak about Muslims and also about Christians. In Quran, in the pickup, the Quran is being completely followed there about the Ramadan fasting, about the 5 times muezzin call, and also about the wearing a scarf over the head. All the things has been followed by Julie, who is a Christian, who picked Abdu from the garage as a life partner. And also, God-man link is always seen in religion. We always relate ourselves to God because when we find difficulties crop up in our life, not because that some God is there, but because we will have a support with God when we get fear in our heart. If that is in the house, then Claudia and Claudia, she when she hears the murder of Carl by Duncan, she completely submits herself to God. And queer culture is not an infringement in South Africa. Gay culture, lesbian culture, all those are there in South Africa. And others in husband says, you, David and Carl, you are all homosexuals. In Empress, he talks about Lady Benita, who is a lady, divorced lady, and she has connection with a girl. And also Seasons of Crimson Blossom speaks about gay culture or gay relationship as well as homosexual. And we see in Burgess' Daughter, they were singing. There were a group of homosexuals singing that is belonging to 18 age group. They speak about it. And we have that in the House Gun, he speaks that so many people, 5 or 6 or 7 people living in a house are homosexuals. And there is nothing wrong in South Africa, and they have completely accepted that. And we have to see the other threads of cultural carpet. In music, dance, food, clothes, cultural elements which adds beauty to the culture of South Africa. And we have to see music is very important part of culture, and dance is also the important part of culture of South Africa. We see their jazz music and also thudding pop music and in South Africa. In all the novels, as time runs out, I am just going little fast. And music came to South Africa because people do not know the art of writing that time. Everything they communicated through music. And the dancers, they celebrated Christmas, they celebrated Yam Festival in Things Fall Apart, all those things. They celebrate Yam Festival and also dancing and singing and having meat and drinking. Everything was carried. That was a type of the living way of them. And also you see, I'll go against with dance is there and food is there. And And this novels, Conservationist, House Gun, Get a Life, Dance with Poor Man's Daughter, Pick Up, all this novel speak about the importance of music and dance. And also because that is a part of the life of the South African people. Here are some pictures I have taken, the traditional dances of South Africa. And the food that constitutes of beans, mealy, and also rice, fish, all these things whichever are relished by them, bread and slosh of brandy. And only at 2-3 quotes I will say that. Set out tomato sauce, marmalade, honey, mustard, bread, mealy, a grass wine, and also usual beers, and also pork sausages, pork rolls, and slosh of brandy, and also they say that yogurt, honey, fruit. So all these things, these people, they were African people, were very crazy of food, and they have they give more importance to food also. And this food forms a great elevate the culture of South Africa. And next is we have our clothes. That are the traditional clothes which they use in any occasion, and that is sort in this occasion. And so I can tell you about Pamela Jude's Dance with the Poor Man's Daughter. I have said that through the protagonist's eyes, it gives out the complete vivid picture of South African culture. So the novels of South Africa completely unleashes the myths and rituals telling us how South African culture was important and how glorious it has been. So now I just give you some recommended novels for you here. Peter Abraham's Mind Boy, We Cried the Children. And this PowerPoint will be shared with the organizers and you can get it. So I'll just go through it. These are the novels I just give you for reading so that you can explore more South African literature, South African culture, and these are till 2019. And these are the novels that has been released in 2020. And these three novels are we expected in 2000, that is October 20, August 20, and then February 2021. And so this is what stamp out racism, say no to racism. This is what the authors mandate, all the writers, because they want harmony in South Africa, where the whites and blacks live together there. And so to conclude, I can ask that when this apartheid was erased in 1994 and the new their government, the black government, taken up the charge, there was the most prominent question, what would the writers again write? So at that time only, this Kotsi was telling, why not? The effects of the apartheid will be lingering in our minds, and there are yet more to light about that. At that time only, the new South African dramatic era was characterized by literary critic Stephane. She says that describes as a honeymoon literature or celebration literature. So celebrating the freedom, celebrating the release from the clutches of the black people, you'll write. Then witness literature was the previous one when they witnessed and wrote it. Now let it be honeymoon or celebrating literature there. So the South African novels are models of statutory books of perception, which any works or any era people can follow it. All the works forays the different problems and predicaments faced by the blacks and the whites in the changing scenario. The predicaments of the blacks or the predicaments of any people who occupies the edges of the society. The authors who optimistically wanted to see the dawn of the people are done, or they have documented, written, they have represented the reality from their heart, and that has happened. And now what is South Africa is only because of the hardships, hard work, and the humanistic vision of the writers. And so through the novels, they have created awareness to all the people through the racial discrimination, cultural diversity, the encounter between the private and the public, thereby bridging the unbridgeable. The authors gave a hope of vision to the readers and the people, and that has happened. And now the people are now living in South Africa with free from the clutches, breathing a fresh life. And so I thought of ending up my this talk with the South African national anthem, but I think that when I clicked on it, it is impossible for me to give it. Please just go to the YouTube and hear the South African national anthem, which is so beautiful to hear, and that urges the spirit of all the people also. Thank you, Onandawa.